Genesis chapter 8, verse 1. But God remembered Noah. Look at your neighbor, tell him, he's remembering me. Tell your other neighbor, the one with the attitude, he hasn't forgotten about you either. Even though he should, but he hasn't forgotten about you either. But God remembered Noah and all the wild animals and livestock with him in the ark. And he sent the wind to blow across the earth, and the floodwaters began to recede. Go to the sixth verse. After another 40 days, Noah opened the window he made in the ark and released a raven. Somebody shout, raven. The bird flew back and forth until the flood water on the earth had dried up, receded. He also released a dove to see if the water had receded and it could find dry ground. Go to the 10th verse. After waiting another 7 days, Noah released the dove again. And this time, somebody shout, this time. This time the dove returned to him in the evening with a fresh olive leaf in its beak. And then Noah knew the floodwaters were almost gone. He waited another 7 days and then released the dove again. But this time, it did not come back. Faith for the last days requires adherence to the following prophetic declaration, this revealed truth, that it's not the raven, it's the dove. I need you, we call this holy harassment where I come from, I need you to touch one person you're going to bother for the rest of the evening. Tell your neighbor, if you don't like it, find somewhere else to sit. Look at that person, tell them, it's not the raven, it's the dove. Turn around and look at somebody who needs to hear it and tell them, no more ravens, just doves. Matter of fact, do it one more time. No more ravens, just doves. Now, Noah was a righteous man who lived in an unrighteous time. Sin permeated the culture, immorality ran rampant, and God's ordinances, they stood ignored just like the world today. But there stood a man committed that his home would be different. Genesis chapter 6, verse 8. Noah found favor with the Lord. Righteousness always attracts God's favor. So God makes a critical decision. Genesis chapter 6 and 7. God decides to make it rain for 40 days and 40 nights and flood the centers of population with the idea of pouring out judgment. And because Noah found favor, and he lived righteously because he had faith for his last days. You build an ark, bring in a pair of every living animal, bring your family, and you will live. Noah believed the prophetic in the midst of the pathetic. Now, this may sound archaic, it may sound old school, vintage. But in the world of constant change, in the world of Facebook, YouTube, Instagram, and Twitter, there are truths that stand forevermore. I am one of those that still believes that, whether some people believe it or not, I don't really give a holy hoot. I still believe that Jesus saves. And I don't care if people are no longer preaching it, but I'm one of those that still believes that Jesus delivers. And I know this is real old school for some, and I know many have swayed away, but I'm one of those that can bear witness. I know that Jesus still heals. I know that he's still setting the captive free. I know that he's still turning things around in our favor. I still believe that. Any believers in the house? Because there are habitations that guarantee success. Now, let me explain this. There's a false theologically skewed teaching that states that being a Christian means we never go through anything. Christianity doesn't guarantee that we will never have problems. Being a Christian does not mean that we will never go through storms. Christianity does not say that we will never experience a flood. What the Word of God guarantees is that if you're in the right place in your faith when the storm hits, if you're in the right place in your mind when the problem arrives, if you're in the right place in your spirit when the flood is poured out, when it's all over, not only will you survive, but you will thrive in a higher place like never before. He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High shall abide under the shadows of the Almighty. Let me ask, I have to ask this. How many have been through one significant big grande storm in the past 2 years? Raise one hand. How many have been through a couple of major hurricanes? I'm not talking about little, no. I'm talking about the major stuff. You know, I'm talking about that stuff that made you go, ooh, that kind of stuff. If you've been through at least two major mucho grande tormentas, if you've been through at least two major, raise both hands. If you've been through so many you lost count, raise both hands and a foot. If you've been through so many that if I Google your name, the National Hurricane Weather Center shows up. Raise both hands and both feet. But if you're still alive right here, right now, because I said if you're still alive right here, right now, if you're still standing, if you're still praising, if you're still worshiping, if you're still believing, if you're still going from glory to glory. How many of y'all know that sometimes you have to go through in order to get to? I got a word for somebody here. Y'all understand that sometimes we got to go through in order to get to. Joseph went through the pit to get to the palace. Israel went through the desert to get to the promised land. Paul went through the storm to get to Rome. Ask your neighbor, neighbor, did Joseph stay in the pit? Did Daniel stay in the lion's den? Did Jonah stay in the whale? Did Jesus stay in the tomb? Well, I'm not staying either. I'm coming out because I'm going somewhere. I'm just going through in order to get to. Here's a word for somebody. Some of us have been through things this year we've never been through before. If it's not for you, you sit down. No, you got nada. Take out your phone. Text somebody. Facebook. Check the scores. Do all. But if you've been through stuff you've never been through before, it's only because you're about to get to where you've never been. You're about to receive what you never received before. You're about to see what you have never seen before. You're still standing. You went through to get to. Some of us shouldn't even be here right now. The devil had every intention to take us out. Am I preaching anybody? Some of us shouldn't even be here right now. According to the enemy's plan, right about this day in September, right now, some of us should be in hospital rooms. Some of us should be in prison. Some of us should be in a bar getting drunk. Some of us should be in a corner shooting up. Some of us should be 6 feet under. Look at your neighbor, tell him, guess what? I'm not drunk. I'm not high. I'm not in jail. I'm not in the hospital. And I'm not. Flood survivors in the house. You're about to see what you've never seen before. You're about to receive what you've never received before. You're about to conquer what you've never conquered before. Please, 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 please. Look at one person, tell them, neighbor, what the devil shut, God's about to open. No. Matter of fact, tell them what you were not able to do in the beginning of the year, you will be able to accomplish by the end of this year. Hey! Yes! 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 Yeah! 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 Yes! Yes! What was impossible in the former shall be possible in the latter. Here to declare to you, you've been through what you've been through to get to where you're going to. This year, look at your neighbor and tell him, this year. 2 Corinthians 3, 7 to 10, Paul says, what you are about to see is so glorious that it will overwhelm you. It will make you say, I thought I had seen glorious, but now I truly see glorious. Because we are, Christ followers are the quintessential storm survivors. We are because we know how to go through in order to get to. I don't care what he, Pastor Samuel, you don't know. I don't care what you look. I don't care if you have a limp, but you're going to get to every single place that God has ordained for you to get to. Faith for the last days requires knowledge that your habitation will determine your destination. When you serve God with what you have, he will take care of what you need. I'm going to say that one more time in English. When you serve God with what you have, he will take care of what you need. Because it's not about the storm or the flood, it's about the ark. Christ is the ark. John 15, 7, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. The world is currently drowning in the waters of unbelief and relativism, of apathy and bondage and sinfulness and fear. It's time to reintroduce the ark. Don't get upset with me now, but I'm not talking about Christ, the hippie on the cross. I'm not talking about Christ, the feel-good therapist. I'm not talking about Christ, the revolutionary ideologue. And I know this is totally politically incorrect. And if you all get upset with me, I really don't care. I live in Sacramento, California. Listen, I know this is politically incorrect, but we need to vociferously articulate the following. I don't care how, I don't care who writes what, I don't care what they declare, I don't care, doesn't matter what CNN says, MSNBC, CNBC, you down of OPP, I don't care what they say. It doesn't matter. We need to, there needs to be a generation committed to the dove and not the raven that'll dare stand up and say, I don't care what they say. There are not five ways to heaven. There are not four ways to heaven. There are not three ways to heaven. There are not two ways to heaven. And I know this is not correct. Mohammed can't save you. Buddha can save you. Confucius can save you. There's only one way, and it's Jesus Christ. There is no other way. Christ the Messiah, Christ the way, the truth, and the life. For in him we live, in him we move, Acts 17, 28, in him we have our being. I'm going to get to you there. So there is, so there is a flood, right? And the lluvia, Dios manda lluvia. And there was rain. And there was rain, and the rain came down, and he had the ark, and Noah's in the family, and they're in the ark, and then the flame comes out, and then the flood, the ark goes up because of the flood, and the flood, and the ark goes, and then there was this mountain, and the Mount Ararat, and they end up at the top of the mountain, and then when the flood was over, and they started here, right, and then the flood water, and then when they finished, when the waters, they were no longer here, they were up here, so before the waters came, they were here. After the waters receded, they were up here. So I said, this is an illustrated sermon. After it's all said and done, you're not gonna be where you started. I'm here to tell you. You're not gonna be where you started. You may have started here, but when it's all said and done, you're gonna end up here. Look at your neighbor, tell him, I'm going up. I'm going up. So they got to the top, and they llegaron a la parte más arriba, y están aquí en la cima del monte, y está llegaron. Somebody, is he speaking in tongues? Maybe. And they're going, and the ark rests, and then here's the part. So they get to the top part, right? And then it's not like they got to the top, and Noah just serendipitously, out of some sort of emotional exuberance, begins to walk out. No. He gets to the top, because some people get to the top and immediately they want to step out. And then they get slapped around like a cheap piñata. Because you can't step out until there's proof of life. You're going to get this in a second. So he sends out. He gets to the top, opens up la ventana, the window, and then he sends out the raven. The raven. Ravens are scavengers. They eat cadavers. They are directly related to dead things, fleshly things. Noah did not step out following the indicative markings and guideposts of the raven. He only walked out when the dove brought proof of life. You're going to get this in a second. And I know you all understand through biblical typology, amplified with the baptism of Jesus in the Jordan, you know very well who the dove represents. So this is critical, because Noah did not walk out following. Raven represents dead faith. Raven represents the dead. You see, you can't speak like heaven and look like hell. You got to put your money where your mouth is. In other words, if you don't give Christianity a bad name, don't give this transcendent faith. If you say you can't say you're a Christ follower and you're always broke, busted, disgusted, where you're a victim, where you're bad, you're giving Christianity a bad name. You can't speak heaven and walk like hell and look like hell and live like hell. There has to be continuity with your prophetic articulation and your vertical alignment and your horizontal life. In other words, the raven, we got people walking out following the raven, following dead dreams, dead memories, dead relationships. By the way, the dead relationships, you may be all right, but the people around you may be holding you back from seeing everything God has for you. I want you to know that your horizontal relationships have vertical consequences. I'm going to say that one more time. Your horizontal relationships have vertical consequences. Look at your neighbor. Tell him, neighbor.
Neighbor.
I think he's talking to you. The world is full of ravens. I need you to understand something about the raven. It's matter of fact, repeat after me, say, it's not the raven. It's the dove. The difference between the raven and the dove is the difference between the pathetic and the prophetic. The raven is the dead stuff. And I need you to understand this. We have too many ravens. We have ravens in culture. We even have ravens in church. We have ravens in our surrounding. The raven is about the old. The dove is about the new. The raven was about, oh, it's dead. The raven reminds you of your past. The dove always leads you to your future. The raven points to the hell you went through. The dove shows you the heaven you're going to. The raven perpetuates fear. The dove ignites faith. The raven says, you are a victim. The dove says, you are more than a conqueror through Christ our Lord. The raven says, look what the devil did. But the dove shouts, look what the Lord has done. Let me give you an example. And again, it's on video so you can see it. I was invited to Pakistan soon thereafter, about a couple years after 9/11, and I was invited to Pakistan. Matter of fact, I went to Pakistan a couple of months after a reporter from a national periodical here in America, a newspaper, was decapitated. And I went to the same region, and I preached in the same vicinity. My wife didn't know that back then. Else, I don't care who, I never would have, anyway, that's just a different story. And so I approach it. The first day, it was the day of the raven. Let me explain. It totaled about 17,000 people in Pakistan. 60% plus, according to the coordinator there, were Muslims, non-Christians. And in the front row on this side were the Muslim clerics seated right here. You could do your Google due diligence and look at it. They were right there. And so the first day I'm going to be on, it was literally the two speakers that were with me, we saw ravens. And because there were different things, the spirit, the stench of death and pestilence and cadavers all around. We saw ravens. And over here, the Muslim clerics, except that some of the clerics here, there were individuals here that were, I'm using sacramental speakies, they were packing. And by packing, I don't mean they were packing handkerchiefs, tissues, napkins. They were packing. And they were right there packing in the front row. And they were making sure that I wouldn't say absolutely anything that would offend the faith of the majority faith of that nation. So the very first, I wish I could tell you that I preached prophetically under this great faithful anointing where we just let it all out. We did it. It was the day of the raven. And we were captured by the culture of fear. The very next day, we meet with the other two speakers, a guy named John Raver and a guy named Israel Bermudez. And we sat down and we said, look, we're going to let it all out. 17,000 people, what's the escape plan? If they start shooting, where do we go? And we calculated escape plans and we found out we couldn't go through here. We couldn't go through here. There was nothing there. There were just walls in the stadium. The only way was going through the middle of the crowd. So we went, all right, let it rip. Second day comes along. So we start preaching. All of a sudden, again, you got to see this. All of a sudden, a dove appears in the midst of the stadium. And I look and I go like, what is going on? And I'm not one that, because of my analytical mind, I'm not one to take everything. But there's no incident there. The day before raven, the next day dove, and the dove appears. And all of a sudden I look and I start preaching. And in the midst of that crowd, I start talking about Christ being the way. And about the power of Jesus. And about the grace of Jesus and the life. But then there came a point in the middle of the sermon that I started getting more and more courageous because I started preaching to this side, ignoring them. And so I ignored them, and all of a sudden it shifted. And it got to this area right here. And with spiritual courage, with prophetic fortitude, clarity, and conviction, I started saying, Jesus saves, Jesus delivers, Jesus heals. And I said, He is the Christ that heals. No other one can heal but Jesus. Right there, I come back to the podium. I'm coming back like this. All of a sudden, an 80-year-old man stands up with a 30-something-year-old son. They start walking across the podium. I'm thinking, I'm gone. It's over for me. No more enchiladas for this Hispanic. It's over. So they come over here. Pastor Jerry is here. We have our security apparatus here. They go, what's the problem? The 80-year-old man starts making some noises. The sun comes up. Jerry, look, Israel Bermudez looks at me and says, you got to hear this, Pastor. Everyone's there. The Muslim clerics are there. 60% plus. They come up here. The 80-year-old man comes up here from the cleric section. An 80-year-old comes up, Muslim cleric. He comes up, and he comes up with his son, and he's going like this. He's going like this. And he's going like this. And the son looks at me and says, Mr., they called me, they thought it was a priest, so they couldn't differentiate between pastor or preacher. They said, Mr. Priest. And I said, well, what is it? And he said, this is my daddy. He's 80 years old. And I go, great. Well, now why are you up here? And he says, we were there in that section. And I knew the section very well. And I said, okay. He says, that you see my daddy. And the daddy's going like this. The daddy's going like this. And the daddy starts going like this. He looks at his son and he starts going like this. And he starts going. And I go, so why is he doing this? He says, you don't understand. My daddy was born blind. The moment you started saying that your Jesus, that Jesus that you preach, that he saves, that he delivers, the moment you said that Jesus heals, my daddy grabbed my arm and he said, son, I don't know what's going on, but my eyes are opening up. I can see. Stood right here. And gave him the microphone. He comes out in front of everyone, regardless of the consequences of his life and his family. He got the microphone and said, Mr. Priest, I was born blind. And he's looking around and he's going, wow, wow, wow. And he's touching his son and he's going, wow. And I'm telling him, follow me. And he's following me. And he goes, Mr. Priest, I pray Muhammad all my life. Nothing happened. Today, I pray to your Jesus. I can see. I no longer serve Muhammad. Starting today, I serve your Jesus. Tell your neighbor, neighbor, there is power in the name of Jesus. Tell your other neighbor, there is power in the name of Jesus. Raise your hands. Here's the word God gave me for you. You're raving. What time is it right now? What time is it? Is that the exact time? 9:10? At 9:10, this very evening, 9:10, right now, your raving season is over forever. For somebody in here, you're seething of dead things, you're seething of dead marriages, dead anointing, dead faith, dead finances, your season of seeing cadavers is over. If this is for you, raise your hands. This gotta be for somebody. If it's for you, raise your hands really high. The Lord told me to tell you, I don't say that out of the womb of emotional exuberance, but of the impetus of God's leading, out of God's word, out of the leading of God's Holy Spirit, I'm here to tell you that your raving season is over. Your season of seeing dead dreams is over. I know this is for somebody right here, right now. The Lord is telling you it's over. It's over, it's over, it's over. That season is over. That faith, the season of seeing cadavers all around you is over. From this moment on, you have stepped under an anointing. Faith for the last days. No more ravens. No more ravens. In your family, no more ravens. In your church, no more ravens. In your finances, no more ravens. Is this for anybody? Shake your neighbor, tell him it's for me. Tell your neighbor, neighbor, the raven season is over. The dove season is alive. Dove people in the house. Are there any dove people in the house? If your raven season is over, give God a shout of praise. Get back home. All the ravens will be gone. I'm gonna say that one more time. By the time you get back home, all the ravens will be gone. Did the dove come empty-handed? What did the dove have in its beak? Do you think it's a coink-a-dink? Out of all of the plants and vegetation on the planet, it could have been an apple, a branch, it could have been a It had to be a olive leaf. If there's an olive leaf, there's an olive branch. If there's an olive branch, there's an olive tree. Out of the olive comes the oil. And the oil represents the anointing. In other words, Noah, it's all right to come out. There's an anointing waiting for you. Don't you dare step out until there's proof of an anointing waiting for you. I decree, I establish, I release right here, right now, that in this hour, you are stepping under the greatest anointing of your life. Tell your neighbor, I'm anointed. I'm anointed. I'm anointed. I'm anointed. I'm anointed. It grew out of the midst of the state. It grew in the midst of this, out of the state. It grew. Yeah. I go to Israel. This is what triggered this word. This is where the revelation came. I go to Israel. The Department of Agriculture representative takes a group of us on a VIP tour. We go to the vineyard of olive tree field. And she's Jewish. She's not Christian. She looks at me and goes, Reverend, see those olive trees? And I go, yeah. She says, how old do you think they are? Man, I'm gonna be honest, I have no idea. So I said, I really have no idea. I know nothing about olive trees. She goes, just give it a guess. I go, 40, 50 years. She went, you're off by a little bit. That one over there is 1,500 years old. It got me, messed me up. And then she says this. She says, out of all the trees in the world, the name in Hebrew for the olive tree is the resilient tree. And I go, why? She goes, because it's known as the storm and the flood survivor. She says, why do you think out of anything that possibly could have emerged first after Noah's flood, it will be the olive branch? She goes, let me tell you about the olive tree. She says, you see, it's fit right here in this field. This place has been flooded to the top, beyond the height of the trees, and they're still standing. This place has been through fires and droughts. The trees still live. And she went, do you know why they live? Because of the roots. The roots are embedded in the hard place. They literally grow within the rock. And this is just a comment she made, because they're connected to the rock. As long as the rock. This is her comment. As long as the rock does not move, the tree will live. As long as the rock does not move, the tree will live. I finish. If you're not standing, stand with me. Okay, you're all standing. Just raise your hands. There's proof of an anointing. Noah did not step out when the raven confirmed death. Noah did not step out when the raven affirmed the fact that there were cadavers and said stench of flesh. Noah stayed inside. By the way, when Noah first initially released the dove brought nothing. The Bible says that Noah spent 7 days with the dove. When you do not have your response in your hands, spend some time with the dove. Spend some time with the Spirit of God. Spend some time with Jesus. He, life. There's life. There's life. It survived. There's life. I'm here to tell you that the vision God gave you still lives. Your calling still lives. You may have lost your money. You may have lost your wife and kids. You may have lost your sanity, but your anointing still lives. Raise your hands. Let's repeat the words of the psalmist. Repeat after me. I will not die.
I will not die.
I will live. One more time, say,
I will not die.
I will
not die.
I will live.
I will live.
And I will declare
the works of the Lord
in my life. I'm gonna finish right now. Don't move, don't move, don't move, don't move. The Spirit of God always brings proof of life. The dove. God told me to tell you the season of the raven was over. You're not going to see any more dead cadavers. You're going to activate the faith of the last days. Not driven by the raven, but led by the dove. The dove always brings life. Everybody say life.
Life.
Oh, John 6:63. The dove always brings holiness. Say holiness.
Holiness.
1 Peter 1:16. The dove always brings freedom. Say freedom.
Freedom.
2 Corinthians 3:17. Matter of fact, I declare, let me redeem the narrative. Once an addict, always an addict. Once Jesus sets you free, you are free indeed forevermore. The dove always brings power. Acts 1:8. Power, 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 power. Power. Those things are right. I'm not saying that a week from now. I'm not saying 3 months from now you're going to experience life and holiness and freedom and power and comfort. I'm saying that as of 9:21, right now, upon every single person here, upon you and your children's children, and your children's children's children. And this is the part that messed me up. Noah steps out. He steps out. He doesn't call CNN. He doesn't call the reporters over. The very first thing he does, he edifies, he builds up an altar of praise. This is the part that messed me up. This messed me up. This jacked me up. That's theological explanation for jack me up. He walks out. He builds praise. And he gave God praise. And this is what the Bible says. The sacrifice was received. God received it. And God said this the moment he received the offering. It says that God said this. He received it and God said, never again. Here's what God told me. Listen, listen. There is a praise inside of you. Not the praise of someone who's never been through anything. There's a praise that was birthed in the midst of your storm. That once it comes out, it has the power to prompt God to look at you and say, never again will you go through what you went through. Never again will you be the tail and not the head. Never again will you be broke, busted, and disgusted. Never again will you be the scorn of nations. Never again will you be shamed. Never again will you go back to Egypt. Never again will you be found in desolation and despair. There is a praise inside of you that when it's released, it prompts God to say, never again. Tonight is the night that God looks at you and your family and says, never. Ready for never again. for never again. Hebrew exegetical expository extrapolation from the Hebrew narrative. All of you theologians, do your biblical Hebrew due diligence. The phrase in itself captures the following. It says that God remembered why he made man in the first place. The moment Noah worshiped, God basically said, I almost liquidated, annihilated. That's what I made him for. You just reminded me what I made you for. Your praise has the power to remind God of the purpose why you're on this planet. Your worship has the power. I don't care what you've been through. There is a praise inside of you that when it comes out. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Anybody know what I'm talking about? Anybody know what I'm talking about? Something inside of you that when it comes out, it prompts God to say, never again. Tonight is the night that God declares upon you. Never again. I'll wrap up right now. I said this last time in the missions and marketplace. The reason why some of us praise the way we do has nothing to do with the color of our skin, the social economic background, our educational academic acumen. It has nothing to do with our cognitive domain, our economic fortitude. Whether you're GED or PhD, whether you're Body or Beverly Hills, we don't praise based on our social economic, our cultural heritage. It's not a matter of ethnocultural, social, economic, political contextualization. The reason why we praise the way we praise is because the size of our praise is directly proportional to the magnitude of the hell that God took us out of. Y'all hear that? The size of your praise is directly proportional to the magnitude of the hell that God took you out of. If God took you out of a little hell, you give him a little praise. But if he saved you, if he delivered you, if he healed you, if he turned you around and set your feet on solid ground, then you give God the highest. No more ravens. 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 I feel a release right now. No more ravens. No more. Never again, never again, never again. And then Dr. Winston, when after he built that altar of worship and praise, that offering, sacrifice, the Holocaust, then God looks at him and says, there's three things coming your way. Now that I've said never again will you go through what you went through. That is outrageous for our worship and our praise and our sacrifice and our offering to carry the potential to prompt God to sign a contract that never again. That's just... And then God looks at him and says, in addition, not only never again, but now three things are coming your way. Genesis 9:1. Prosper. Multiply. And fill the earth. Let me give you other Hebrew terms. Three things are coming your way as a release of this anointing right here. Prosperity. Multiplication. And fulfillment. Somebody say prosperity, multiplication, and fulfillment. Tell your neighbor, neighbor, there are three things that God today has unleashed upon your life. Prosperity, multiplication, and fulfillment. If you receive it, give the Lord a shout up. In Genesis chapter 9 verse 1 is a derivative tangential term that stems out of the word shalom, which you know very well. In there, prosperity doesn't just mean prosperity, it actually means where nothing will be missing and nothing will be broken. I don't know about you, but I receive that word. When God tells you, you just step into a season and anointing where nothing will be missing and nothing will be broken. That should prompt you to put on your dancing shoes and give God the best praise you've given him thus far in this place. Raise your hands. We got minutes here, so I just... There's an anointing, God. No more ravens. Just a dove. Your raven season is over. Your season of seeing cadavers and dead faith, dead integrity, dead marriages, dead finances, dead dreams, dead visions, dead relationships, that season of death and cadaver and stench is over. The dove, the Spirit of God, the Spirit of Christ indeed. And you seal the deal with the sort of worship and offering and sacrifice that'll prompt God to say, never again. We got minutes and I'm going to respect that time. If you say, Pastor Rodriguez, this word was 172.3% for me. If it was only 105%, don't respond. But if this word had your DNA, your mitochondria, your genome, if this word had your social security number on it, if this word was 100% for you, I'm gonna give you 30 seconds to come out of your seat and make your way around here right now. Go, right now, quickly, quickly. Only if it was for you. Make your way over. Stay right there. Make your way over. Just step out. Step out. You're just demonstrating. You're stepping into the fullness of this word. Never again. Never again. Can I have the worship team come and join us? Never again, never again, never again. We have a couple of minutes. I want to pray over you. Never again, never again, never again. Never again. Come up with your hands raised with the faith of the last day that is activated. Oh, never again, never again, never again, never again. Never again. Nunca jamás. Nunca jamás. Te profetizo en el nombre de Jesús que la hora del cuervo se ha terminado. La temporada del cuervo se termina hoy. La temporada de cosas muertas, de sueños muertos, de finanzas muertas, de una fe muerta, se termina hoy. Ha llegado la paloma sobre tu vida. Ha llegado el espíritu de vida sobre ti en esta hora. Ha llegado el espíritu de Dios para confirmar que hay vida. Y vida en abundancia. For your raven season is over. Your raven season is over. This is the season of the dove. The perpetual, unending, unbridled, uncompromised season of the dove upon your life. With your hands raised, there's an anointing here. As we speak right now under the anointing of God, that the Spirit of God, the Spirit of Christ indeed right now is releasing life, new life, life abundant. He did not just come to give you life, he came to give us life and life abundantly. Abundant living begins right here, right now. Comfort, he is the comforter. Power, you shall receive power when the Holy Ghost comes upon you. Power, power, freedom, freedom. There's an anointing, there's an anointing. Freedom, 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 freedom. Power, yeah, 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 yeah. Oh, shote maremosa. Yo, yes, yes, yes. Fresh, a fresh olive leaf falls upon you right now. It is a fresh anointing for this season. Fresh, fresh, fresh. With your hands raised, with your hands raised. Oh, oh, oh. No more ravens. 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 No more ravens.